This evening, we welcome the award-winning photographer, constant photographer, Velibor
Božović. I have to take a picture of everybody because just so I could prove to my wife that I was actually doing something tonight. Far away.
Proof positive. We welcome Velibor to the series. Velibor earned his MFA here at Concordia in the Studio Arts Department, an alum joining us today in the series. He's the recipient of the prestigious Claudine and Stephen Bronfman Fellowship in Contemporary Art for 2015. Through his photo-based art practice, Velibor explores how images influence memory and what role they play in the space where the historical, the fictional, and the personal relate. The memories and spaces at issue are charged ones. Velibor grew up in Sarajevo, Bosnia-Herzegovina. When he was in his 20s, the country of his youth turned into a war zone, and he spent the duration of the siege of Sarajevo honing his survival skills. In 1998, he moved to Montreal, where for 8 years he worked as an engineer in the aerospace industry before devoting his time fully to image creation. We're glad you made that move. His images have traveled widely. In the United States, Cuba, Canada, France, Germany, and Bosnia-Herzegovina. Through them, we get to travel too. Down back alleys in Canadian cities, in his series Deep in the Woods, Some Kind of Nature, and past tombstones in Bosnia and Herzegovina, in his series Stone Speakers, for example. These pictures are modern, sharp, tightly composed, and confrontational, or roving and curious. But they are old too, ancient even. What we are given to see in the images was first heard, it seems, by Velibor in real or imaginary natural and cultural histories. The faint protest of trees growing through fences and around power lines in the city in deep woods. The whispers of the bereaved as they gather around medieval grave sites in Bosnia in stone speakers. These voices and Velibor's pictures of them are quiet and frail, but insistent. Velibor's work crosses disciplinary, cultural, and geographic boundaries. He sets fictions in dialogue with historical records, sometimes cheerily, sometimes somberly. The images and their various crossings are contemporary. One of my colleagues called this a talk of the moment, contemporary in that sense too. They're contemporary in an art historical sense and in a broad, urgent public sense. The art historian Terry Smith has argued that since the 70s, the discipline has struggled to name anything like a contemporary style or movement. Documentary strategies of the conceptualists and the installation strategies of post-minimalists have been taken up outside Europe and North America in emergent art scenes across the globe. But the purposes of these styles have changed for Smith according to local needs and decolonized visions of art and art history. In place of movements or styles then, Smith suggests a short list of tendencies in global contemporary art. World picturing and place making seem like relevant ones as we turn to Velibor's work. What do cities as different as Montreal and Sarajevo, as they mingle in Velibor's imagination, have to say to each other or to teach each other? Do the lines we draw between them disappear or get thrown into relief in the work? What kinds of places does he make and invite us to share? And in doing so, what kind of a world does he urge us to picture? Velibor, we're very happy to have you here. Welcome.
Well, thank you, Tamer, for just doing half of my talk. So, I'm kidding. First, thank you everybody for the patience, and I have to say I'm really incredibly, incredibly honored to be standing here and being given the opportunity to talk about myself and my work in this environment, and for that, thanks to Tamer and whoever else came up with this idea. Concordia University, the Faculty of Fine Arts, and especially the photography department were really, really good to me in the last 6-8 years since I'm around. And being a product of Concordia, meaning I finished my BFA and MFA here at Concordia, it makes it especially nerve-wracking to talk here. I've done talks in some other universities and some colleges and festivals, but here seeing all the friends and colleagues, it's kind of especially nerve-wracking. So, but hopefully I'll go through it somehow. So, I also want to say I'm a proud immigrant, and as most immigrants will confirm, at one point we get tired about explaining ourselves. We always have to, whenever you have a new acquaintances, you somehow have to explain yourself. And since I have lots of people in the room, which is beautiful, I prepared lots of things to show you so I can do this explaining to many people in one shot. So when we meet next time, we can talk about hockey or something. Also have to say that now as we are witnessing this extraordinary events south of the border, and it was really preparing for this talk in the last couple of days was really hard to kind of focus and to understand even why is this important and why are we doing all of this, because it seems that it doesn't make any difference anyway. Should we just be better off spending an hour here and talking how to organize against the raising fascism all over us? Or we talk about my work? I guess we have no choice tonight, but maybe after we can talk about how to fight this. So some stories need to be told, and I'm going to tell you mine. I will go back and kind of tell you where I come from and anything that happened in the meantime until this point. So let's start. This picture was taken in 1984 in Sarajevo, in Bosnia and Herzegovina, in Yugoslavia, or as people like to say, ex-Yugoslavia. And the city of Sarajevo that year hosted the Winter Olympic Games. I was 18 years old. I had a band. This is two of us, my best friend, and who you will meet throughout this presentation a couple of times, and myself seated in this Fiat 500, this classic old car, with some of our equipment. Life was beautiful. I was a high school student then, had no concern about the future whatsoever, just like most of the high school students of that age. Anywhere. Future was not much of a concern. So that was 1984. Only a decade later, in 1994, when this picture was taken, the country of my youth, Yugoslavia, was no more. It ceased to exist. The city I grew up in was in flames. And that band we played was well forgotten, obviously. And the city of Sarajevo was besieged. And by then, I was a 2-year war veteran serving in the Bosnian army defending the city. This image was taken, I found it online and only found out later it was taken by a Bosnian photographer, Kemal Hadžić. What was interesting to me when I found it online, it looked like it was taken from my apartment in Sarajevo, but it was just actually a floor down. So this is basically the view that we had every day for 3.5 years of the siege. This is kind of like a typical day in the siege of a city. And I can tell you, as much as you can't imagine your city or your country in flames, we couldn't imagine it either with the same intensity. The problem is that the fact that we can't imagine something doesn't mean it's not gonna happen. And I think that's very important at this moment in history where we are at. Who could have imagined that even just a few months ago, that in a country like United States, the United States, of all places, capitalism will finally defeat democracy. because that's what's going on. And it's happening right in front of our eyes, and it's really hard to even talk about anything else. But I promise I'm not going to talk about it much in this presentation, because it's just the beginning. It's going to get much worse because before it gets better, I can promise you that. So this was 1994. Only a decade later, I already have a 5 years experience as an engineer in a Bombardier aerospace in some faraway Canada, in some Montreal, of which I, in 1994, knew as much as that it also hosted the Olympic Games at one point, and not much more than that. So I've been working for 5 years already at this, in this picture. And this, in this picture, it's, I'm posing proudly in front of our product with my colleagues. So if we zoom out, that's us. I'm somewhere in there. That's the whole team. Let's jump one more decade, and it's 2014. And I already completed BFA and MFA, and we are family of photographers, so this is my graduation picture from Place des Arts. It's a great picture, I love it. So this 80, 90, 2000, 2014, this little timeline just tells you how all this to say, so much could fit into one life. And in my case, it was just like, I hope, half of my life. And it rather seemed all nonsensical. There is no clear connection from one to another. Like, it's so unpredictable. So this spread is from a book by a fantastic German writer, late, unfortunately, W.G. Sebald. The book is called Austerlitz. And in his work, which I refer to often, he's one of my, for sure, favorite writers ever. And he kind of dismantles this notion of an individual who has everything under control. You know, like we have our fate under control. That's mostly like North American myth, how we, you know, as individuals, we can control our life. It's only up to us, you know. If you want something, you did something, you know. It's, if you fail, it's your fault. So he dismantles this in all his books. And because every time he thought, he had things sorted out and it has all under the control, something happens and just undid it all, you know. And it happened to me, and it happened to all of us. And right now, it might happen to all of us on a big scale. Yeah, so in his work, Sebald kind of tries to make sense of our existence, which is really rather nonsensical often. And this also translates into his working process. So he never worked systematically, he says. And he always embraced the discovery, because things happen along the way. And they do. So, because there has never been a time that nothing happens, right? So let's go back to early 2000s. So that friend of mine from the first picture, that's him again. He's been living in Chicago. He also, of course, was a refugee from Bosnia, and he ended up in Chicago, and he was, by that time, a writer with two books published. I worked as an engineer in Bombardier Aerospace, but very early in my corporate job, I realized that I need to do something else. So to keep myself sane, I from the corporate environment, I started taking photographs. So I was one of those people that, now pretty much extinct, that I was photographed. I would find an excuse to leave the house on the weekends, and then I would photograph something, and then during the weekdays when kids would go to bed and everybody falls asleep, I would go in a back room where I made a little makeshift dark room and started developing. I taught myself how to print and develop pictures. So that's what I started doing. At the time, I knew nothing, absolutely nothing about history of photography, or even less about the contemporary photography. Maybe a little that I picked up from magazines that I was buying. And here are just a few images from that town. And maybe it's obvious that I didn't know anything, but those are the images. So in 2003, in the winter, in the beginning of 2003, I showed some of these prints to that best friend of mine from Chicago. And he just started thinking about his next novel, and in which there would be a writer and photographer, like this fictional character. So he invited me to work with him and to travel with him on a research trip across Eastern Europe for what's going to become the Lazarus Project. So this is the cover of the Lazarus Project. But the novel deals with the real life death of Lazarus Auerbach, who was a young Jewish immigrant who escaped pogroms in Eastern Europe in the early 20th century, 1906-7, and then ended up in Chicago. And just a few months after, for unknown reason, he was at the door of George Shippey, who was the chief of the police of Chicago. He was at his door, and George Shippey killed him. He was unarmed. And the idea of the whole project originated from this photograph. This is a photograph from the Chicago Historical Society archives. And what you see here is Lazarus Auerbach seated on a chair and some police colonel or something standing beside him. All these ghostly people are well alive, but Lazarus Auerbach is dead. They are showing Lazarus Auerbach to the public because there was a big outcry because of this killing of an unarmed man. And to kind of justify this murder, they were showcasing him to the public, pointing to his chin and to his nose and to his ears, saying how obviously, based on these features, he was up to no good. He was an anarchist. So at that time, the anarchism was a threat to capitalism. And more so, lots of Jewish people were a threat for some reason. So they were singled out, just like 100 years later, some other people are kind of on a target. And we all know how that ended up when it started in the early 20th century. How did it end up in the Second World War? So phrenology was a big science at the time where, you know, based on the features of somebody's face, you can say he's up to no good. So they did everything to justify this murder. So in our book, in Sasha's novel, 100 years later, these fictional writer and photographer travel to places where Auerbach came from. To kind of in an attempt to understand the places he left behind before coming to America to be murdered. And that's what Hemon and I really did in a real life. So published in May of 2008, book included a number of my photographs and also photographs from the Chicago Historical Society. In it, we kind of juxtaposed these historical images and documents to contemporary photographs that I took and the narrative. And but the photographs, while they were depicting contemporary Eastern Europe, because that's when we went, they also kind of stand in for this fictional photographer that was in the book. So I took a month-long absence from work, from Bombardier, and off we went to this trip. I took one camera and one lens and about 40 rolls of film. That's much how I knew what I was doing, because if one of these pieces of equipment broke, there would be no Lazarus Project as such. It would be a very different book without photographs, if there would be a book at all. And as for the images, they were really the images, the only images I knew how to take. They were traditional kind of road trip snapshots along the way. We spent most of the time while traveling discussing these two characters, building these two characters, this writer and photographer. Where would they go? What would they think? How would they interact with the world around them? What would the photographer photograph? So we kind of inhabited the minds of these two people pretty much most of the time. So, but also the book, if you ever read it, it's a book about Bush America. It's a book about when the Iraq War started, this invasion. And it's also a book, when Sasha was writing this, that's when Abu Ghraib pictures came into the spotlight. So book kind of deals with these two historical moments back in early 20th century and then early 21st. So these are some images that I took while we were traveling around. We met lots of people. We saw lots of places. We saw traces of the world that disappeared in Holocaust because, you know, apart from a very, very few little communities of Jewish people, there are just cemeteries that are left. And the Lazarus Project really translated all over the world. It won a number of international awards and in best novels in Italy, in Switzerland, and here and there. And it was a finalist for the National Book Award in the United States and for the National Book Critic Circle Award, and had these incredible reviews all over the place. That's obviously all due to Alexander's incredible talent. I'm not taking any credit for it. But for me personally, it really led to the first exhibitions of my work. And that was kind of something new for me. So this whole creative collaboration with Alexander, which on this project lasted from 2003 until 2008, when the book was finally published, so it took 5 years, it really changed my way of reading images. It's changed my way of understanding them. It changed so many things. Most importantly, it changed my way of participating in this world, and it really led to a few radical changes in my life, including abandoning engineering career. Well, all of that in combination with PTSD, you know, that all led to leaving Bombardier. And in 2008, in the spring, the book was finally published. And a few months later, I enrolled in the undergraduate photography program here at Concordia. One fun fact for all of you who maybe doubt what you do and, you know, like you haven't figured it out and, you know, you're doubting yourself all the time. I was 42 years old when for the first time I walked into Concordia to sit in the class. So I'm not gonna show you any of those projects, but it was a fascinating and fantastic experience for me because all of a sudden there was all these other people around me that I can talk to about photography, about art. There was these amazing teachers that I could learn from. There was these facilities that I don't know if they exist anywhere in the world, and all this equipment, and I could do all these different things. First, you have to do it. It's a requirement to do color, to do digital, to do large format, to do. So all of a sudden, I tried it all. I did it all. So, you know, and plus you learn to do traditional photo essays and a little installations, and you do time-based images. It really opened me up. It was a fantastic experience for me. So I'll just show you a couple of images. This is my final undergraduate project. It was a book called Shiver, or Summer Tales of North. And basically in this book, it's kind of cycle of images included, like they documented the travels that I did on the edges of the Arctic Circle during summer months. I visited with some other friends for some other little project of his, but obviously I did on the side my projects. We visited Russia, Iceland, Canada, Norway, and stuff. So I made this little book, and also, you know, this is a shot from Fofa Gallery, because I don't do this much, but I see it all the time, like installation views, they're important in these kind of presentations. So after graduating BFA, I promptly enrolled in MFA. I was first one on the waiting list, I'm proud to say, and I squeezed in because somebody went somewhere else. So, but being a graduate student and being a student in general, I can tell you that my experience with studying was like, it was like permanent vacation. It was after working in the corporate world 8 to 6 every day, and sometimes even longer, and very often on weekends. All of a sudden I found myself, I have so much time. So, which means I had so much time to think about stuff. Then I realized for 15 years, at that time it's been almost 15 years since the war started, even more. I have never had a chance to think, to reflect, to recollect, to remember. Because it was war, then it was immigration, then it was one child, another child, there's mortgage, there's job, there's this and that. It was so much happened that you never just had a chance to reflect. And now I did all of a sudden. So, I could think about past, try to remember things, and I could, including the war that I completely erased from my mind for all those 15 years. But remembering turned out to be a really difficult problem-solving activity. You have this baggage that you carry full, you have this knowledge that you accumulated, but there's also a bunch of feelings that you have no control of, and then there is this conscious remembering when you try to remember something. It just doesn't work. But I also, as I was entering MFA, my interest kind of started together under one umbrella. Before that, I was all over the place. But memory, archives, time, history, personal history, storytelling. This interest in how images influence memory and what role do they play in this space where the historical, personal, and fictional kind of interfere and enhance one another. So also I knew by that time I don't have a talent to, I'm not an artist who can create something out of nothing, like so many amazing people can. And I'm sure in this room there is many amazing people who can just lock themselves in the studio or whatever environment they like to work with, and they come up with stuff. And that stuff speaks to people, and it's a great art. Well, I don't have that talent. So I realized early on that I needed, that everything I do originates in something that has already happened, or at least something that there is a possibility that it happened. There was a potential for it to happen. And around that time, I saw there was a great exhibition in MAC here. It was some retrospective of Andri Sala's work. Andri Sala, who is this Albanian-born artist who I think lives in France. And I saw his film, Intervista. I don't know if anybody saw it, but seek it out. So in this film, artists actually discovered, it's a real life story. He discovered a 20-year-old 16mm film which contained the images of a Congress of the Albanian Communist Party back in the 70s, where he recognized his mother, artist's mother, giving a speech, because she was a leader of a communist youth alliance back in the 70s. He could not make out what she was speaking about because the sound recording was lost. So all he had was this film without any sound. So he hired this lip reading specialist from the School for the Deaf in Tirana in Albania, and so they to decipher her speech. So in this film, Intervista, he's showing these scenes where he's showing his mother for the first time this film with her words subtitled. And she's in disbelief that she was saying what she was saying. And then there's this amazing clash of past and present within one person. It was really, it's really well done. So Intervista was really important discovery for me because it kind of hinted at the possibility of working with personal stories that are somehow part of a larger historical context. They are still relevant, you know, because, you know, we all have this problem, I think, you know, you have a personal story that you would like to work on, but then, you know, why would anybody care? Then, then you meet somebody and they say, yeah, why would I care about that? You know, it's your story. But the way the Intervista was done, you know, like it kind of encouraged me to look into this because that was at a time as I was started, when I started thinking about my prisoner story. So, story about my prisoner is that in 1994, I was serving in the Bosnian army in Sarajevo, defending the besieged city. But just 30 kilometers away, Sarajevo was besieged, and then, you know, like Sarajevo people, we dug a tunnel under the Serb occupying forces, and so there was another territory controlled by the Bosnian army. That's how the city really survived, with food that came out through this tunnel. But so as I was serving in the Bosnian army, at the same time, on this other area controlled by Bosnian army, my father was a prisoner of that same army. So he's in a prisoner of war camp. So the same army kind of controlled both of our fates. I was their soldier and he was their prisoner. So we really lost contact in the beginning of 92, didn't know much about each other until 1994, when these powers that be, or higher ranking military, whatever, decided that we could be reunited for a few minutes. And that all sounds kind of nice, but what actually happened, I was blackmailed that, yeah, maybe we could arrange that you can see your father. And I said, wow, yeah, great. And then they said, yeah, but if the TV crew will be there to record it. So I'm not going to go into details, but this father-son meeting was organized, and TV crew was deployed to record it. And it really, in this recording, you know, you have presumably on the opposite side of the war, right? Me, father and son. And but we met for a few minutes that they allowed us, and it was the camera recorded these really bone-crushing embraces and sobbing and humiliation that we went through, and this it really recorded us playing roles in somebody else's script. And 2 months after they filmed it, after I saw my father, they showed this as if it happened just that day in a primetime daily news. So 18 years later, as I'm starting my MFA and start to think about these things, I contacted somebody in Sarajevo. I have lots of friends there still, and somehow got hold of this archival footage. So when this disc arrived my home with my name on it, I kind of knew, you know, that the footage on it is simultaneously propaganda, because that's why it was made. It was also a historical document, but in the same time, it's a record of my personal experience. And this whole question of when you remember things, like, do you remember what you experienced? Or if there is a record of it, do you remember the record of the experience? Which one is stronger? So I was thinking about these things, and then as soon as I received the disc here, I called my father, who is, by the way, fine and well and lives in Bosnia still. And I told him, because I had this vivid memory of after we were reunited in the room, and I'll show you a little clip of that. And then they took us out, and I have this memory of this guy, Zvonko Marić, who was a well-known reporter, war reporter, standing there with me on one side and my father on another, and he's asking us questions. So I called my father and I said, you know who I got in touch with? And he's like, who? I said, Zvonko Marić. And he said, who's Zvonko Marić? I said, well, the reporter, you know, that interviewed us when I visited you in camp. And he says, like, to my shock, he said, I was interviewed by a woman, I don't know, Anis Vonko Maric, and I don't know who were you interviewed with, by, because they separated us after the meeting in the room. And then we had this little argument over the phone. I was like, no, Dad, you're losing it, you know? It's like, it says, well, no, that's it. So then I, you know, decided, okay, I got to do something with this, because obviously my memory and my father, this was the, until that point in our lives, probably the most traumatic experience that we went through, and we have a completely different memory of it. So that was very interesting for me. So this audiovisual record of what happened served of kind of as an opportunity to recall something that which I, me or my father could not, could no longer remember accurately. But after watching the footage, I realized I was also just like my father, interviewed by a female reporter, and then my memory was a complete construction of many things, because Zvonko Maric was obviously there, because in some other, like, he was either producer of the thing, or, you know, and he's the guy that I kind of traced back in Sarajevo to get the footage. But he never interviewed us. And we were separated. My father was somewhere else. So somewhere along that time, I kind of shifted my focus from what I could not remember, but was recorded, to something that I think I can remember really vividly and clearly, and it was never recorded. So I realized I had to reconstruct, to reimagine the moments that led to the father-son reunion. So that was this. There is this beautiful moment when they were taking me in a car to visit him. I was, for one reason or another, heavily medicated, sitting in the back seat of a car. And they were taking, there was an intelligence officer next to me, the guy who organized it all, the brain behind it all. So we are driving to this beautiful woods, this empty road. And you know, like in all war situation, the music that you hear on the radio is either some horrible patriotic songs or some horrible folk music, anything that will bring emotions of the people one way or another. So. But I realized that something is off, and once the guy turned on the radio, and I realized it's "Shine on You Crazy Diamond" by Pink Floyd playing on the radio. So I don't know how many of you don't know the song, but it has this really psychedelic 12 minutes intro, you know. And I'm sitting there, and I'm all like losing it. So just to break this moment of madness, I turn around to the guy and I say, "Good music," and the guy says, "Yeah, Jean-Michel Jarre." So, yeah, we were two worlds apart. I realized at that moment, and that was the only conversation we had. And he did not recognize the track. And so I wanted to recreate that moment. And so I was like bouncing from one memory trace to another, from one reading to another, because I was reading about this remembering thing and memory, and you know, from one decision to another, from one artwork to another, and that whole process resembled more and more what Zebald was talking about, when actually he described his process as when you're watching a dog traversing the field. So from the outside, it looks that this dog's search is completely nonsensical, and his ways are unplottable, but the dog always comes back with something that he was looking for. So, and that's how he described his working process. And this is really what happened to me here. I was bouncing all over the place, but I came back with this video footage, that the sequence, rather, of images and sounds of that last 22 minutes or so. And it was called My Prisoner. So in its final form, it's kind of a work that reconstructs these events of the April 3rd of 1994. And it shows this young man you know, which is obviously now a fictional rendering of the of this car ride, and then there's also the footage of the archival footage of the visit. So really, my prisoner for me navigates through this space where the historical, personal, and fictional bounce of each other. So it was the first time it was shown installation view from in Ignition in a Bina Gallery, and that was a wonderful experience. But then, yeah, this was from my in Matra Lab in a black box. It was my thesis. And then it traveled a bit to Paris and Berlin in a festival. So I will now play a 3-minute clip just so I can get my voice back. One of my best friends over there. So that's a little excerpt from about 22 minutes film. I don't want you to read my notes, so I need to change to this and then to change to this. Oh, to go all the way. Okay, it's not much. So I just want to mention this one little project that I really enjoyed doing so much. It's called Encore Odyssey. It's an installation containing books, some photographs, and the audio or sound piece. At the heart of it, it's really a collection of books that I acquired from two secondhand bookstores here in Montreal. One is called Encore. It's very close to where I live in NDG. And another one's called Odyssey, which is very close to Concordia, where I also live. And unfortunately, Odyssey was closed about a year and a half ago. So all I have now is Encore. And every book in the set that I get has a date inscribed. Most carry a little more elaborate, have some names like of the readers, and some have more elaborate inscriptions. But each book, and that's the only criteria for me getting it, is marked in a different year of the 20th century. So I, 90, 78, 79, 80. So not when they were published, but when somebody inscribed. So at the end of the project, there will be 100 books, each representing 1 year of the 20th century. And it's not meant to be a collection of important works by any stretch. It's a collection of works that at one time inspired an individual to leave their mark on it. And when they are, the way I see it, is when they are brought together with all these embedded stories that are written in the books and with these little snippets left by their readers, the books kind of form a new narrative that for me is as visual as it is literary as well. And the important thing is, like, in the 20th century, well, for the good part of it, most people really did not have a public life. Public life was reserved for a few. There was no internet, social media, Twitter, Facebook, so most people were just living private lives. And these inscriptions were also meant to be private. They entered the public sphere the moment when these books were pushed into the book market, which is most often when people would die and then their children would get rid of their books. So I kind of see it as a Twitter of dead people. And but some inscriptions are very interesting, and some look beautiful just because the books are. And there's also lots of historical references, like in this one, For Alan, a Dear Friend, where it's 1984, which is for the future in Germany. So that was just before the wall's gonna come down. It was obvious that something's happening. But then I also read through all of these books. I mean, some of them are really crappy literature. Some of them are classics. So I don't really read them from beginning to the end, all of them, but flip through and I pick up a paragraph from each one of them, and then I have that recorded in a studio. Jake Moore, who most of you probably know, generously provided a beautiful voice, and she's reading all of these paragraphs, and then I edited in kind of a new narrative separated into little thematic units, like about childhood books, paragraphs that talk about war, about love, about death, and stuff like that. So that this audio piece kind of gives life to the content of each book, but also somehow establishes connection between those original readers and the audience. And the resulting installation, the way I see it, of course, is that it evokes something that also it's a Sebald's, my favorite writer's proposition, that all the moments in time coexist simultaneously. That's what he claimed. And so somehow with all of this in one room, I would like to think that this is the case. So the project was shown once in exhibition curated by Lon Dubinsky, who is right here in the audience, shown in a Stuart Hall gallery in Pointe Claire. And at that time I had about 60 books, 60 years covered, and right now I think I have 87, so I'm missing 13. But it's been at least a year the last time I went to actually, because I never go there just intentionally to look for these books. When I go to that bookstore, you know, like if I happen to. So it's been 5 years already, so who knows, might take another 50, because smaller the number of years missing, harder it is to find them. I also, from time to time, every once in a while, come back to photography and make images, because that's what I like to do. And also, I like to make images without much preconceived ideas, and because so I'm going to just show you some. And this is from that project that Tamara was talking about, Deep in the Woods. It's where I actually walked out with a 4x5 camera and met people, and they would all inquire about what the hell is that, and I would say it's a camera, and or the guy would come and say, can I have a cigarette? I said, yeah, if I can have a portrait. And that's how all these images were made. And another thing happened, you know that terrifying moment when you're finishing MFA and you're like, what the hell now? Like, all the community's gone, all the people. Because, I mean, the reason that I, in the first place, my primary reason to come to study to Concordia is because I needed people. I needed people I can talk to. I needed community. And now you're finishing and you're thinking, now you're losing that community because you've got to go out in the world. And, you know, I've been in the world already. I don't want to go out. You know, I want to stay. So, but I was lucky, because around that time, as I was nearing close to be finishing, Raymond April invited me to join the group that she was just forming. It was called Autre Vie, or Afterlife. And it's basically a bunch of people, mostly photographers, who from and around Concordia, who have very, like, they have similar interests. I mean, we all do different things, but we can all talk about them. And for me, it was a great experience. By the way, I'm a huge soccer fan. If you want to talk soccer to me anytime, anywhere, please. So this was the best way I could present the group, is as a team sheet for the soccer club. So you can see all the names there. And of the people involved. And it was really like a continuing education for me after finishing MFA, because there are so many amazing people in this group that I can learn from every time we meet. And we meet quite regularly, discuss personal projects, but also we work together on projects. We have a couple exhibitions behind us, and we're going to have one in a month in Mumbai at a photo festival. And publication is in the works. So this brings us now to what am I doing now? You know, I was never the person that clips. I'm old enough to be that person, but I was not that person that clips articles from newspapers. But a couple of years ago, or 3 years ago, I was cleaning up my junk and things in my room, all this paper and stuff, and then I found this article that I clipped, clip from the Montreal Gazette from 2007. And I obviously took it out, I stored it and forgot about it. But then about 3 years ago, I found it. So the article talks about how in 1988, to mark the 150th anniversary of photography, the city of Montreal designated 6 streets within a new housing development to be named after the famous, important historical photographers. In a little place in Rivière-du-Loup, a Pointe-à-Tremble on the northeast part of the island in Montreal. Sorry? Rivière-des-Prairies, sorry. Yeah. I should read my notes. Rivière-des-Prairies, yeah. So, thank you. So the new neighborhood was drawn, and the names of William Notman, Alexander Henderson, George Arl, Edgar Gariepi, Ovila Ala, and Conrad Poirier. They found their place on the official city map. There they remained for 19 years. So the city was printing this map. All the official map of Montreal from 1988 to 2007 have this neighborhood and these streets. But in reality, they were never built. Nothing's ever been done. So in 2007, when this article was published in Gazette, the city retracted from this plan, trashed it, and the names of the photographers were removed from the maps and never to be printed again. So obviously, as I was reading this, it was very interesting to me. I mean, like, first I was shocked that I was really shocked that William Notman does not have a street in Montreal. Like, how is that possible? And so it was 8-9 years after when I was reading this, after it was published, after the streets were officially taken away, I kind of located the area in the Google Street or Google Earth. I'm not sure what it is. And the designated area is a wasteland, really, until today. I mean, wasteland is not a good word. It's a piece of woods, pretty much untouched. But there's nothing there, man-made. And I don't know why, but how did I even come up to the idea? But I typed Rue William Notman. And there it was, 9 years after it was officially taken away. The greatest photographer the city will ever have was in this beautiful space there. And he was not alone. Henderson and Gariepi and Poirier and everybody's there. Yeah. So strangely, and I like to think stubbornly, somehow these phantom streets still appear on Google, on Google Maps. We would think that by now, you know, in this day and age, things get updated instantly, or at least in a very short period of time. It's been almost 10 years. Well, this year it's 10 years. I don't know if they're still there. It might be. But these photographers refuse to disappear. I know I'm romanticizing it, but that's how I like it. They refuse to disappear. They're still there. And obviously, that was very interesting to me. So that's where the Nothing Will Surprise You Here was born. That's the title of my project. Of course, I had to visit the place. So I'm going to show you a few pictures. That's how it looks. It's woods, and it's beautiful. It always has water, sometimes up to your knees, depending on the season. It's just a gorgeous place. This is in the summer when the water is not that bad, and spring. So as I was getting to know this place, I also started to read a lot about literature, about, you know, definitions and about space and place and cultural meanings of it, and, you know, how our experience affects those places when we visit them and stuff like that. There's this fantastic book by Yifu Tuan, who is a professor somewhere in the States, called Space and Place, and I would really recommend everybody to read it. You know, I read lots of literature like that. I also started revisiting, you know, stuff like Benjamin's arcade projects. I rewatched Wings of Desire by Wim Wenders. I watched Open City by Rossellini and stuff like that. But I also needed to learn a few practical things. I was really interested, how do you get the street name? How do you, you know, what needs to happen for that to happen? So I'm talking a little bit more about the process here because there's lots of students here that I think it's kind of interesting. So if you're bored, I'm sorry, but it's like, how do you get a street name and all these decisions, you know? And then I contacted first this person who wrote this article, and then she pointed to somebody in a toponymy department in the city, the department that deals with street naming, and they were very helpful. I met with them. They explained me the whole process. Then they pointed me to the city archives in the city hall, where I was given these four boxes because I was looking for these decisions from 1988. I was really curious to see what kind of files they have to put together to justify that they are giving a street to Alexander Henderson or somebody, you know. And I obviously had to learn how to deal with these microfilms and scan them all. You know, one of the, actually not the street, but it was a park, was named Géa Martin Photograph, which is a fictional character. It's a film. It's a quite well-known Quebec film about this fictional photographer. So that was also interesting. And this is how those documents look like, approximately. And they also compile files. There's lots of magazines and you know, the articles that they clip to, you know, and put in a, like you when you apply for grants, you know, you put your little file together. It's quite similar thing. And yeah, this is about Conrad Poirier. So, but and also what happens is usually the district that or the arrondissement, when they want to name few streets, they kind of either propose the streets or they just go to the city and say, give us seven names. And then the city looks at the location and they actually think about it. And they if there are some historical references, in this case, somebody thought about 150th anniversary of photography. But all of this research, all of these readings, all of these visits were just really a pretext for what I really felt I need to do for this. As magical as this location was, I felt like just documenting it, photographing or recording, it's not really what interests me so much. And I was definitely not interested in doing yet another project on any of these photographers, because there are some amazing projects that are currently being done and they've done in the past. But this idea of a potential neighborhood just wouldn't let go. So there was supposed to be a neighborhood there. You know, it was a residential plan, residential development with its buildings and shops and schools and parks and playgrounds. And it was supposed to be there. Some lives were supposed to be lived there. And so the potential of that neighborhood can really never be taken away. It will never be built, but that potential that sits there in the past can never be taken away. So at one point I realized I'll have to make it up. I'll have to make up this neighborhood somehow. I just didn't know how. Then one night I was reading Borges' story, beautiful short story called The Circular Ruins, in which the main protagonist goes to sleep in order to dream up a man. And it's a little quote I'm going to read for you. The purpose which guided him was not impossible, though it was supernatural. He wanted to dream a man. He wanted to dream him with minute integrity and insert him into reality. At that moment, I realized I don't need to make up the neighborhood. I'm going to dream up some people and insert them into reality. So I decided to dream up some fictional characters who grew up at that neighborhood. And so I dreamed up a man and a woman. This is Gustav. And this is Catherine. And so I wrote a script where these two people meet regularly at this location, and they talk about stuff. And they talk about people. We don't know who they are, but they talk about these people. They share some stories. There's obviously a connection between them, and they seem to share some intimacy, but it's never really clear. Were they lovers at one point? Were they just grew up together? They were friends, they were family. But they meet at this place throughout every season. We're gonna see them in every season, and they talk about stuff. They tell each other stories about people with whom they obviously share some kind of history. So, you know, this dreamed up neighborhood is kind of a home for people that lost their place in the world somehow. That's how I see it in any different ways. It's a project about the possibility, potentiality. It's a project about dreams unrealized, but they resist the actual. They resist the reality. So that was my goal. So these characters, they kind of bring up the importance of storytelling, importance of imagination, and images. Not necessarily to record, but to create new realities. So this is my working process in this. I have to share this, like, because this was the first time I was working with a project that originated in some geographical location that I've never been before. And there was this story around it, but I've never been to this place. I didn't even know where Rivière de Prairie is, or even if it's Rivière de Loup, you know, like it's like. So, just quickly, that was my starting point. I was there, and there was this mythical space, because, you know, I'm imagining this space. I know nothing about it. This mythical space. So this is kind of a timeline. So as you start moving, and as I was starting to visit this place, in the same time your mind is at work, and I was acquiring knowledge by going into the archives and, you know, reading stuff. Also, my imagination is at work. You know, I'm imagining things all the time. And then there's this life of different feelings that you have as you work through the project. So at one point, this mythical space with this fuzzy ambience kind of starts to turn into a place. You know, there's this overlap here where the place, with all this experience, starts to kind of to acquire reality. You know, there's a concrete reality. You get to know the place. You know, you can actively think about it, like not in abstract terms, but you can reflect on it. So this space turns into place somehow, and then all of these things come to the end point where there should be my project. I'm not there yet, obviously, but the problem is that all of this should be in that point over there, and if it's not, then it's a failure. So I wanted to share this little project. So finally, I just want to mention that, by the way, this nothing will surprise you here, will be in Dazibal. Opening is on April 13th, with publication as well. So I'm happy to invite you all to come and see the show. It's going to be there for 2 months. So, but I'd like to mention that Alexander, that's the guy there, who's the writer from the first slide, and I, we started working on a new project. It's definitely going to be a book and maybe something else, which is a collection of stories about Bosnians who were refugees some 20 years ago, just like Syrians and many other people are now. We talked about these projects for years, at least 4 years now, but finally started interviewing people last summer. We all started from the same place, from Bosnia, from this little country, and the trajectories and things that happened to all of us, and wherever we ended up now, it's very different. And the stories are fascinating, what people went through in this voyage, and each one could really be a book on its own. So far, we visited people in Iowa City, in St. Louis, in Miami, in Paris, in Brussels, in Marseille, in Chicago, and this Friday, I'm actually going to Charlotte, North Carolina, of all places, and I'm terrified. So if they don't let me in, I don't know what's going to happen, but we were supposed to interview a Bosnian Muslim refugee who's on top of it gay. So when they ask me at the border, what am I doing? So I guess I'll have to lie, because if I tell them this, I can't believe we are in this place right now. Obviously, this idea for the whole project came as a response for this constant last 4 years of Western media coverage of these refugees and these people that are running away for their lives, you know, is this some imaginary huge lump of a problem that's bouncing around. Nobody's talking about people, about lives, about individuals, that what they go through, and unless they wash on the shore and they are 7 years old, you know. But otherwise, it's like just this big problem, this migrant crisis. So, but the fact that each and every one of them has really a unique experience that we can all learn from, so we decided to tell some of these individual stories. So we meet these people in their homes, in cafes, or at their workplace, or in their basements, wherever they are comfortable talking. The shortest interview we had was 3.5 hours. The last one we had was 7, and we even didn't get past the war in that last one. And these are just some of the images I'm showing you of the environment in which these interviews are made. And yeah, so Bosnians are coming. You know, now that the United States doesn't run the world anymore, I think we're thinking of taking over. And another announcement in next week, and for the next 2 months, if you find yourself in Toronto, you can visit the exhibit Memories of Stone. I think Tamara mentioned this project a bit. It's a project that I worked with Amila Buturović, who's also Bosnian, but also teaches humanities and York University. And we, for 5 years, traveled to medieval cemeteries in Bosnia. There is already a book published about it, but there will be an exhibition in Ismaili Center. And alongside with the works of Azraq Shamia, who is also a Bosnian, who is a professor at MIT, she's an artist as well, and who just a couple of years ago actually stood here and gave this same very, they gave talk in this same very same series, Conversational and Contemporary Art. And finally, nothing will surprise you here in Dazibal, April 13. And I have to say that this project would not be done or be possible without the Claudine and Stephen Brofman Fellowship in Contemporary Art, which was a big, big help. So yeah, thank you very, very much for the patience, and I really enjoyed this. And yeah, if you have any questions, either here or outside smoking, I'm available.
Who was the man in the car next to you, and who was Zvon Komarić again? And also, is it possible to see it on the internet, the work?
Well, the last question, no, not really. I mean, I don't have it in its entirety anywhere out there. I'm not sure I understood the first one. Who?
You said someone called you and said you could meet your father, but only if the TV crew was there.
Yeah, well, it was the military that I was serving, that somebody in a higher ranks that came up with this idea. Because, you know, everything you see in the war, really, in the media, is propaganda, and it's made for some purpose. So they thought how, you know, it would be a great thing to show, you know, this father and son who are supposedly on the opposite side of the wars, how this army is so generous to kind of provide us that we can see each other, and, you know, like as if that's a great humanitarian thing to do. But obviously that was not the purpose of this visit. And the man in the car, you know, so those two men represent my previous self, the younger man, and the older one represents this intelligence officer that, so it's basically reimagining the scene that actually happened when they were taking me there.
And is it possible to see the work anywhere?
Maybe we can organize a private screening, I don't know, but
okay.
Yeah, maybe maybe in your class, I don't know.
Okay.
I'm definitely open to showing it to people. I'm not hiding it, but it's not online. It's not available for anybody to click on it and watch.
Thanks.
Velibor?
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you and your father got to be on opposing sides?
Well, it's actually quite simple. You know, in a war, it's very easy to be in the wrong place in the wrong time, and my father was. But he was also, before the war, he was an officer in the Yugoslav army that was slowly turning into the army that actually besieged Sarajevo, turning into Serbian army. Well, he didn't have a chance to do anything because he was at his regular work at the very beginning of the war, which was not even clear if there will be a war, and when he was taken by these people from the area and taken to and being imprisoned. It's a chaotic situation. You know, when the war, it's not like one day you wake up and they say it's war today. Okay, guys, let's start war. You know, so it's the situation where it's very muddy for quite some time, and everybody is like, and I remember, you know, every day, my mom would say, "Oh, you see, it's not shooting much. It's done. It's over. You know, it's not gonna be that bad." And everybody's saying all the time, it's not gonna be that bad. And we hear it now, Trump, you know, it's not gonna be that bad. It's gonna be very bad. So it's, so it was in this little chaos at the very beginning where he was taken. And we really didn't know for at least a year anything, because that was, when you say camp or prison, it's a nice word. These were like torture places. And this particular one, it took, Red Cross more than a year to actually get access to, and that's when we found out that he was alive and where he was actually, because for a year we didn't know even that much. The rest of the family was in Sarajevo, my brother, my mom, and myself and our dog.
Thank you so much, Velibor. Yes, like this?
Yeah,
close. Okay, thank you so much, Velibor. I was really curious about, or I am really curious about, the script that you wrote. And can you just talk a little bit about what your thoughts were about that process, or how you came up with that script?
As I said, after reading this Borges story, I decided, okay, I need to dream up some people, and because I felt, rather than imagining the neighborhood or rebuilding it in some way, I mean, neighborhood is nothing without people. So people is what make neighborhood, right? So I decided to do this, and I. It's hard to talk about the script because. Not many people read it so far. And, you know, when somebody asked my friend Alexander at one point, how do you know, I was in one of his talks, you know, similar situation like this, and a student asked him, how do you know when you do all these different drafts of your novel, of your book, at which point you know, how do you know that's it, now it's good to go? And he says, it's all shit until it isn't. And you got to be able to recognize that moment. So I'm still in this moment where it's all shit. So I can't really, so it's hard to talk about it. But basically, in this script, there's two people, just two people, walking around these woods and talking. And they revisit the place. It looks like he lives there all the time and she just visits here and there, but she obviously have a connection to the place. Their relationship is not clear, but they like to talk to each other. And then they bring up all these other people, just like I think we all do when we meet somebody from our youth, where we grew up, and then you know, oh, do you remember that guy? Or do you remember this? Oh, you know what happened with this guy? But they also kind of talk about other stuff that's not really related about specific people. So the script is very, very simple, and there's not much going on. There's two people talking, but then I think in every conversation something's going on. So it was, I mean, it was definitely the first time. The only script I wrote before in my life was for My Prisoner, and it has these two lines. Good music. Yeah, Jean-Michel Jarre. Because that was the only dialogue. But so this was the first time I was actually, you know, writing a script. And I mean, script is a really heavy word. It's like, I don't know what it is. I was writing a dialogue between two people, you know, and imagining them walking through this space that I, at that time, already knew very well because I visited the space many, many times in different seasons.
Something seems, just from the images, it seems very phantom-like.
I hope so.
Yeah.
Thank you. So, that's encouraging for
okay.
me.
Okay, and do you, you know, see that as kind of an outgrowth of the book project, the Encore Odyssey project?
No, not really, but I think everything I do is, I think it comes from the same place. So there must be some bouncing, you know, from each other, all these little projects. Project. I started, you know, I'm at the point where I really hate the word, but have no replacement for it. We all have projects all the time. Project, such a bad word. Okay, is there anything else? Any suggestion? Like, yeah.
Velibor, been wanting to ask you this question for maybe a year and a half now. And we're at a lecture in public. Here's my chance. I've noticed something very particular about your works, especially in terms of video and photography. I think what's extremely unique about what you do is that you manage to make the connection really strong, from my perspective. I guess my question is just, do you see any real connections between the two mediums?
Yeah, of course, I do, but they're also very different mediums. And I mean, I am a photographer. That's what I started with, you know. But when I think of every project, every work I start, I really don't know what am I gonna use. Images or video, or maybe I'm right about it, I don't know. The stories kind of dictate the means. I don't really care. Is it gonna end up being photography or video installation or a book installation or whatever? So, I mean, yeah, they're obviously connected. We have still images versus moving images, but I mean, in technical terms, but I've seen many projects where both were used really effectively, and but they can also works. They could work against each other.
I have, listening to your talk, I was thinking about the Kurosawa film Dreams, a whole set of short vignettes, and in one series, a bunch of soldiers come out of a cave because they don't realize they're dead. And
okay.
They can't actually ever go there. And so in some ways, it's a little bit related to Laurie's comment about phantom, because I do feel that there's this real sense of haunting, not in the ghost-like sense or the Halloween or horror sense, but the idea of phantom. And I was thinking about people who suffer from phantom limb, who've lost a limb, but have a memory of that limb. And one of the ways to relieve the pain from that phantom limb is for people to have a mirror, so that they see their body whole intact again. And surprisingly, that has proven to be, in many cases, a really effective way of treating phantom limb. And so I'm wondering, in this, with your work and the relationship to image, because again, that mirror is kind of an image, if that is also, if the image functions, or how will you see the image in relationship, which is material, into this notion of kind of haunting or phantom?
Yeah. Yeah, well, I don't know either. I mean, we can talk about it, but in this particular case, you know, I never, like, these two people, they were never real, they never will be real, and they, as when I was writing the script, even they were talking about very real things and simple things, like they were phantoms themselves for me. And now the image, you know, I ended up using video. First of all, I wanted them to talk, but also I wanted them to walk these streets. You know, like nowhere in this project there is an explicit reference to the city of Montreal or the streets and the names and William Notman. But for me, it was really important that it was done at that location.
In all the work?
All the work. A kind of haunting.
Well, I'm a haunted person. You know, somehow all these projects are very personal to me. So they all come from the same place at the end. And I guess it tells something about myself. I really don't know how to answer the question, to be honest with you. It's creating new reality in a way, and then when you create new reality, it's not really reality. It's like there's something haunting about it. I mean, it's like there's no way around it, because there is always remains of something unstable, you know. So there's this resistance constantly towards actual and reality, whatever that is now. It's especially now, it's really not clear what reality is.
Velibor, thank you so much. Incredible, courageous work that you've done. And I just want to know a couple things. With regards to your mentioning PTSD earlier, how has the work evolved for you with regards to how you deal with PTSD? That's one part of it. And the other was the scene in the car and the horses. And I have to say that image was really quite powerful. And the feeling I had was actually nausea as it loomed out upon me. And I wondered, and you had mentioned earlier on that you were medicated, I believe you said, and I wondered about this memory.
Well, first of all, the horses, I trained them for 3 months to do what they were supposed to do. No, it was a lucky accident. We were just driving this road that nobody really drives. And in Bosnia, because of the war, actually, you have a lots of what used to be domestic animals just on the loose, and lots of horses in the mountains and the woods, and lots of stray dogs, and, you know. So that was an accident that was kind of nice, because they also, you know, this whole project talks about this entrapment, you know, like, and then there's these free animals, beautiful animals, roaming around the woods and crossing the roads, and everybody has to stop to let them pass. So, yeah, well, PTSD, you don't know that you have PTSD until somebody tells you that. And, you know, like, obviously, I was through the war, and it was very traumatic, and, like, I think every person that was there has had PTSD in some way or another. It just, you know, but then I came here, I worked for a long time, and then I fell apart in 2006. I just fell apart. I was for 6 months in bed and thinking I'm dying because I have this or that, you know. But there was nothing wrong with me physically. So, I'll tell you a quick story. They sent me to first psychoanalyst. So after two sessions, I wanted to kill this woman because I didn't want to talk about my mother and my early childhood, because everything's fine with my mother and my early childhood was beautiful. I needed help now, not to talk, you know. So that didn't work. So they sent me to this psycho. It's a shame. I can't remember whether he's a psychotherapist or this is psychiatrist, the guy. Beautiful man. And I went to his, he was doing these sessions at his home. So after a few sessions, and I was complaining about my job at Bombardier, how I hate it. I hate being there in this meeting, listening to bullshit all the time, and you know, knowing that 75% people could just be let go immediately and nothing would change, you know? But then, as we were speaking, after three sessions, we kind of got friendly, and he said, can I tell you something? I said, yeah. He says, I know that I shouldn't be talking about my life in these sessions, but I really can't do this anymore. I said, you can't do what? Like this psychotherapy. I'm dreaming about opening my own business and doing my thing. And I'm like, really? But that's the moment that helped me the most in all this work. I knew I was not alone. I mean, there's this guy who's as miserable as I am, and you know, I'm going to seek help. So we started talking about his decision. So I was encouraging him, so why don't you do it? And listen to this. So that's happening in 2007, like spring. So now it's 2008, first Monday after Labor Day. I get in the metro, I'm going to my first ever class at Concordia and in the EV building. So I get out of the metro and I pass and there's that Yugo juice. You know the place? I pass, I look, and that's him behind the counter. And I'm like, I come and I say, what the hell is going on? He says, what are you doing here? I said, I'm going to my first class. I quit my job. I'm cured, you know. He says, well, I opened my business. So, yeah, I always fondly remember that those moments. So, yeah, you know, it was just a process. Because problem with PTSD is that you don't deal with it because you don't know you have it. You kind of don't think about it. You know, you say, oh, no. But, you know, you have to deal with it at one point, you know. So in my case, it wasn't really that bad. I mean, it's like, and it's not like I did not lose anybody in the war. My family was intact. We all survived. So my experience was nowhere close traumatic to mass of people who lost whole families, who lost the dearest people around them. So, you know, but everybody that comes from Bosnia has some kind of form of PTSD. I can tell you that even those people that were not there, but they were following the news every day and calling, trying to find out what's going on with there. Because I have many friends who left just at the very beginning, and it wasn't easier for them than it was for us that were stuck in Sarajevo. So war affects everybody. It's like if you're connected to it in any way. Is there a question that I missed? Yeah.
If you can answer these questions, I'd be really grateful, but I think it might be a question for the bar and a discussion with everyone, and it's actually your questions that you began your lecture with. Like, what are we doing here as artists? What do we do? Does it matter? And should we be talking about fascism?
Well, definitely we should be talking about fascism because it's all around us. It's even here, you know, we like to think, oh my God, we have this liberal government and it's so nice and rosy and they say the right things. But they're coming. I can tell you that much. And if you follow a little bit, they're coming. And we saw what happened in Quebec City the other night. And just gotta be ready. You know, you call them out. When you see him, tell him what it is. When you gotta confront these people head on, right on. Otherwise, they're coming. We already know all these conservative new couple people that are speaking the same language as we are witnessing across the border. So, yeah, we should be talking about it every day in classes and everywhere, because, you know, like it's really easy to say, oh, it's not gonna be that bad. But you know what's happening now? You see them, you know, like they do whatever the hell they want once they get the power. And if we allow them to get the power here, then we are in the same trouble. So we should be talking about it all the time. That's my humble opinion. Not that I'm an expert, really. But I saw it. It was the same, really, because we lived in Yugoslavia. That was this beautiful country. You know, you could sleep in the park. It was so safe, nobody would touch you. And we did. You know, we would travel around the coast, spend the whole summer sleeping anywhere. It was such a safe country. It was such a beautiful country. People were so helpful. And all of a sudden, with the same kind of rhetoric that we hear, the same kind of demagogues came, you know, it fell apart so quickly. You know, when just before the war started, there was like a million people on the streets of Sarajevo demonstrating for peace. 7 days later, they were all against each other in the trenches. So, yeah. And I wasn't kidding when I said, as much as you cannot imagine this place burning, we couldn't imagine our place burning. It was burning all around the hills when we were sitting in cafes in Sarajevo and saying, nah, it's no way it's gonna happen here. And the city was burned completely very soon. So all I'm saying is you just can't take these things lightly, because these people, they're coming. They're coming. And they're encouraged big time. So.
Is there a bar they won't find us in?
You know,
where to hide and continue the conversation.
Like a few months before the war started in Bosnia, me and Alexander were in his country house in the mountains, on the skiing hill. And he was saying, you know, because the war in Croatia was already raging. Croatia was already burned. And we are sitting in Bosnia in the middle of it, thinking, nah, it's not going to be that bad. But then we said, you know, if something happens, we're going to just come here to the cottage in the mountain. And we're like, you know, that's how much you know about it. You know, there is no place to hide. You gotta fight these things, or, you know, there's no place to hide. I really don't want to be that person that's kind of, oh my God. No, it's fine. I mean, but we just have to be really, really careful here and take these things seriously. That's all I'm saying. Because, I mean, I experienced it once. I really don't want to experience it again. And, you know, I'm not saying that somebody's going to come and burn our cities, but it's enough if they just, you know, come to get my neighbor. It's as bad as come to get me. And that we should be careful about these things. Does this have to go on YouTube, like all of this? I'm gonna hate myself if I ever watch this. It's like, what the downer? Yeah.
Maybe we'll stop there. Thanks for a wonderful wrap-up question, Ingrid, and a lovely answer. You've given us lots to think about. Thank you, Velibor, very generous presentation.
Well, thank you all very, very much.